Okay, so trapezoids and kites. On Friday, we went through trapezoids. I need to make sure I'm going to look at and see if this video is posted for that. If all fails, it'll be online today. Now, just remember for the week schedule, tomorrow, that's Tuesday tomorrow, and Wednesday, we're going to do the practice guide. So kind of keep that in mind. I'll hand them out. We'll go through the first page. Wednesday will be the second page. Thursday, Friday this week is our test over chapter 6. That's kind of what you need to know. Today, put the goals up here. We're going to go through a couple definitions today. Basically, kite and trapezoid. I want to review trapezoid real quick. And then we have three theorems, that, or maybe four. We ended at, what, 6.23 Friday, I think? About a trapezoid. So we have 6.24, 6.25, 6.26 today. I'm going to kind of click through them pretty quick. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on them. I'll probably spend the most time on 6.24, because I think it's interesting, but the other ones will just kind of blitz through them. And then we're going to play a little review game. The review game today is to help us with the actual theorems, not the vocabulary. We already went through the vocabulary terms, the whole bingo game thing. We did that. Those will be, I think that PowerPoint's online, so I'll check that as well. And it has all the words on there and what the definitions are. So you can click through that if you want to review some of the words that could be potentially on that test. These are fair game for the test as well, which I think that was already on the slideshow, but not the word kite. So that's what we're going to get to today. Okay, questions with what we're doing? Okay, so goal state, let's review trapezoids, the definition, some vocab terms with it, and then those three theorems that we did. 624 is the new one. I should have moved that over to the next category. This is a new one today. We didn't get to that one on Friday. I kind of want to end it at a certain point early Friday so you guys could actually work. The goal today is to introduce kites for the first time, like the definition of a kite, which some people are very, very confused by, so I need to make sure of that. And then we'll go through the definition, vocab terms with that, and a couple theorems. And these are the theorems, these two. I'm not going to prove them. We're just going to kind of look at them and see what they basically state. They're pretty straightforward. They're nothing like super difficult that you need to know. A homework is due today. If you did not turn in Friday, we had homework due today. That was at 4:26, 4:35. That was the one that Ms. Steffens handed out on, I believe, Wednesday last week. So that one is due today, at the latest. Some point today, I don't really care when, but some point today, maybe this one you need to work on.
Paige Rasmussen, please come to the office. Paige Rasmussen.
That was based on squares and rhombus. So, okay. Questions with what we're doing here today. I'm going to go through this pretty quick, the reason why I want to get to that review game today. Give us some time to actually like practice with these theorems, get familiar with them. When we get to that review game, you will need your notes and a textbook in front of you, not a computer, textbook, preferably. And you'll just need one in whatever group you're in, so that you guys can kind of look up stuff, or maybe two. Okay, so that's kind of the idea, okay? All right, but trapezoids, let's do a quick review of those definitions. So this is what we talked about. It's a quadrilateral with one pair of parallel sides. So top and bottom are parallel. What we talked about on Friday was what we call those parallel walls. We call them bases, right? Those are the parallel sides. They usually have the little pink arrows that you see here. The other two walls are called legs. They're the non-parallel walls. They're like tapered together. They'll eventually meet somewhere up here. And then we talked about base angles are the angles formed when a base meets a leg. So there's actually four angles here. And if it's a random trapezoid, they're all different. The only thing we talked about on Friday was that these two things could add up to be 180. That was one of the things we talked about. When you add the ones that are up and down because of the parallel walls. Okay, questions with the definition of trapezoid, what we talked about on Friday. And again, if you weren't here, this will be online. You can download the slides or watch the video even before, you know, Thursday, Friday this week is when our test is. Okay, isosceles trapezoid is where it's a slightly modified definition, right? That it's a quad with one pair of parallel sides and the other pair are congruent. So in this case, the bases are parallel, the legs actually turn out to be equal. So bases are the parallel walls. The legs are what they call the congruent non-parallel sides. That was a big deal. Like this one right here was a huge, huge deal because we talked about when we talked about theorem 612, that was in the middle of chapter, because theorem 612 had a really similar wording to this. And we kind of compared them back and forth. Theorem 612 talked about parallelograms, not trapezoids, so that was the difference. Okay, and then obviously it still has base angles. But the big thing about base angles on this one is that certain base angles are actually equal if it's perfectly isosceles. So I actually didn't put the marks here. I probably should do that when I post that picture. Okay, questions, comments about the two definitions we had on Friday? Perfect. Okay. 621, this is the one we did Friday. This is the one that I talked about with the base angles. If your trapezoid is isosceles, which means isosceles, trapezoid, the base angles are equal, like this, you have a couple pairs. But it has to be isosceles, trapezoid. Two walls have to match, two walls have to be parallel. We talked about how to prove that. If you want to like see like the actual like rigorous proof of how that actually works, what we talked about on Friday was, you draw a perpendicular line from F, you draw a perpendicular line from J, and what that does is it makes right triangles. These are right triangles. And in fact, the two triangles, even though they don't look like it, they're actually the same triangle, just because of these, we had a hypotenuse and a leg. These legs are actually the same size, and the reason why, they're in between parallel walls. So when you do a perpendicular, they're actually the same length. So those legs are the same, and the hypotenuses of those right triangles are the same. So by HL theorem, or the inappropriate acronym, those two triangles are actually equal to each other. And so then it forces the angles G and H to be the same. And then what we talked about Friday was that when these angles are the same, it forces these two angles to be the same. And what's the angle right here? What's this angle right here in this corner? Those angles be right where those question marks are. It's a set number. How do I make those lines? 90 degrees, yeah, they're perpendicular. So this is a 90, and this is a 90. In fact, how I know that they're alternate interior. And why that's important is because if I add this 90 degrees plus this angle, and the 90 degrees plus this angle, which these two are already said to be the same, they do make the same angle. So all the base angles are actually the same. That's actually the reason why we did it. We talked about that on Friday. The second theorem that we talked about on Friday was theorem 622. 622 was talking about if your trapezoid has one pair of congruent base angles, then it is an isosceles trapezoid. I think I proved this one on Friday. We talked about how to use it with diagonals. I'm going to show you a completely different way to do this. So the goal is you're given certain angles are the same, so the base angles are the same. These two angles are the same, and those two. We're trying to prove this situation, that these walls are actually the same. That we're trying to prove that the picture is isosceles, that two walls match. I proved it with diagonals. Here's a different way to do it. This is one that I kind of saw. I did it later in the afternoon because I was trying to create different ways to prove these for different classes because I was trying to find the easiest one. And this is one that I kind of stumbled upon. When you draw a line and you make this line parallel to the top, I don't really care where this hit. Okay, you just make this line coming from point M, you make it parallel to this top wall. Well, what is this shape? I heard it. Yeah, it's a parallelogram, right? How we know it's a parallelogram, the opposite walls are parallel, right? And that's important, because if I have a parallelogram and I made this wall perfectly parallel, right, these two walls are parallel, this angle can jump to here. That's called a corresponding angle. One's inside of two parallel lines, one's outside. And it forces this little wedge triangle to actually be isosceles because the two base angles are the same. So these two walls would actually be the same because when base angles are equal, the walls are equal. That was like theorem 4.2 way back in chapter 4. Well, if that's true, then these two walls are the same, so I can transfer this mark to here. And then just like I heard, this is a parallelogram, and we already know the opposite walls are equal, so I can transfer this mark over here. So in fact, this picture is true, that it is isosceles, because I can transfer the mark across. I think I did that like period 7 on Friday, and I thought it was kind of cool. I'm going to show you that. That was just a completely different way of approaching that. All right, and again, that was the converse of the last one. And then this is the one I believe we finished with on Friday. That if your trapezoid is isosceles, prove the diagonals are equal. Okay? And I did this by different methods. I saw these kind of in the book. One way that we talked about on Friday, and I think I did this the same for every class, was I proved like this big triangle, that wedge right here, is equal to this wedge. because of the way that the angles work. Because if this is truly an isosceles triangle, trapezoid, like the two walls match, then the base angles here have to be the same. So now in this big triangle here, I have a wall and an angle marked, right? That's the big triangle. And on this triangle going this way, I have a wall and an angle marked, that wall and this angle. And they both share this bottom wall, it's called the reflexive wall. They both triangles have that as their base. And so by side angle side, the two triangles would be equal, this triangle and this triangle. Well, why I'm doing that is because the whole point was to prove the diagonals are the same, these sticks. Well, that has to be true. The two triangles are equal, so those walls have to be the same. And that was a different way to prove it. I think your book, when I looked at it, there's two parts of this proof, right? I think the book, what you can actually see in your textbook, they prove that they start with the diagonals being equal, prove that it's isosceles. Well, I did the opposite. That was the one we kind of talked about on Friday. Okay, questions, comments about the theorems? Spend a little more time on that than I wanted to. Okay, new stuff today. Let's talk about the new word that we're going to come up with, and this will lead us into 624, mid-segment. You need to write this word down. This is a brand new word. It's a very easy word. We've actually used it before when we talked about triangles, but a mid-segment, by definition, it can work for any polygon. I'm just going to apply it to trapezoids here. A mid-segment is a segment that connects midpoints. Well, that's easy. That's why they're called mid-segment, right? It's a segment that connects midpoints. And we're just going to do it for the legs of a trapezoid. So here's your picture. Okay, so we have a trapezoid. This line right here is called the mid-segment. Now, what is a midpoint? Let's discuss that word. We've seen that word since chapter 1, but what does it mean? A midpoint. What is it short for? Midpoint. What do you think? What does this word mean? We've seen it since chapter 1. We've actually had it in a couple different chapters. Anyone remember what midpoint is? Because we're shy today. Midpoint is the middle point. That's what it's short for. Middle point. So middle point of this wall, like if it's a perfect middle, let's call this like point M. That means it's the middle wall, that means these two walls are the same. That's what it means. It means the middle point of the wall, it's equal distance from both sides. And that's the same over here. Let's call this N. That's a middle point, so that the two walls are the same. What we're doing here is we're drawing the line that connects two of them. So we're drawing the line that actually connects those midpoints together, so N and N. Now, why it's important? Because we've actually seen this before. We did it with triangles. You know, we can draw lines across triangles and whatnot. But the reason why is that when you do it for a trapezoid, it makes a very specific type of property for a trapezoid, which is actually unique. This problem in particular is one that I always see on an ACT. It's one of the questions that kids bring to me, and they're like, "Mr. Ward, I had this problem on my ACT. I don't know how they figured out the numbers." And it's always this problem for some reason. They like this property. It's called a mid-segment. Okay? So that's the word, right? They're drawing a line in the middle of that trapezoid. Now we're going to learn why this is important, like what you can do with this. That's what this next theorem is going to be about. Okay, is there any questions about the definition? Okay, so let's get to this theorem. So here's what it says. It's a mid-segment of a trapezoid is parallel to each base, and its measure is half the sum of the lengths of the bases. So I'll let you write that down. I know that's a lot of words. And this one I said today I was going to spend the most time on, was this particular theorem. So a mid-segment of a trapezoid is parallel to each base, and its measure is 1/2 the sum of the lengths of those other bases. So once you have this written down, I'll do the whole proof here. The proof is actually kind of rigorous. It's kind of lengthy. I'm just going to draw a picture proof of it to show you kind of how it works. It requires one understanding, which I think you can wrap your head around once I explain. Take one particular thing that's kind of tough. But after that, it's kind of easy. Now, going to give you an example to start with so you kind of know what I'm talking about. I'll give you just random numbers, and then I'll prove it. Like, why does it work? Okay. Do I have the definitions? People are still writing. Okay. For those who are done, here's the picture. Now, it was the same as the last picture. I just turned it sideways. It really doesn't matter how you want to do this. This is just what the book talks about. I'm gonna do my example on this one, and then I'm gonna prove it on the last picture that I just showed you. Because I'm just gonna show you the example here. Okay. What I'd like is I'd like two random numbers, please. Two numbers. 15 and pick a number that's bigger.
17.
Okay. So 15 and 17. So let's say those are my numbers. Now these are the bases of that trapezoid. How I know that? They're parallel, right? Those are the parallel walls. This is that midsection. That's that new word that we're talking about. That's what this theorem is explaining. So what they explain in this whole group of words, they say what they want you to do is sum those bases together. What does the word sum mean?
Add.
So we're going to add 15 and 17 together. So we're going to go 15 plus 17. Okay? And then once we have that answer, that number, that digit, you're going to take half of it. Okay, so we had 15 plus 17, and then whatever the answer is, we're going to cut it in half, we're going to divide it by 2. That will be the length of this stick right here, the mid segment. So 15 plus 17, what is that? Is that 32? And we divide it by 2, which is 16. That's the length of this wall right here. This mid segment going up and down right there is exactly 16. It's the number directly in the middle of the two bases. It's that mid wall. So it's, you add the two walls together, the bases, you divide it by 2, that's your mid segment. Well, it makes sense. If one wall is 15, the other wall is 17, 16 is the number perfectly in the middle of it. That's how it works. And it works every time, but this has to be a mid segment. So these have to be midpoints that are connected. Okay, any questions with what it's explaining to you?
What if it's an odd number?
Odd numbers, it doesn't matter. It'll be a decimal in that case. So if, let's say, you added your numbers together, and this turned out to be, so I'll get rid of these. Let's say this turned out to be, you added them up, and it turned out to be 11, right? And then you divided it by 2. Well, it'd just be 5.5. And that'd be the length of the wall. Yeah, you'd get a decimal. So, good question. Any other questions with that? That was good. Okay, now I do want to explain, how does that work? Like, why is it always half? Why is it the middle number in between the two walls? So if this wall is 5 and that is 6, you add them together to make 11, you divide by 2, and it's 5.5, that's the length of that stick. Well, here's why. I'm going to go back to the last picture. Let me click back here. Okay, so I'm going to go to this picture. I'm going to prove it with this one. It's a lot easier to see. Okay, now the one understanding that you need to know is that these walls are actually parallel. That's one of the things you need to see there. They are parallel, they're equally spaced, they're not gonna run into each other, and that's a property because of the way that these are midpoints, that all three walls here are parallel. Okay, so how they prove this, and this is really goofy, they start right here at this point, let's call this point P, and they draw a line from point P going through this midpoint. I think I called this N earlier, going through that, and then it keeps going, right? Goes this way. Okay, so they draw that line. Sorry, I totally missed point N. It's supposed to hit point N. Can't draw. All right, so we have that line drawn. Now, eventually, do you agree that if I were to extend this wall further, they would eventually meet over here somewhere?
Yeah.
Okay, so it eventually will hit, down the road that way. Okay, now why did that? Why? It's because I can actually prove that this triangle right here, this triangle, this little wedge piece, is actually equal to this triangle right here. And it comes down to a simple understanding, is that when you have multiple parallel lines like this that are somehow equally spaced, they are equally spaced. How I know that? These bars tell me that. But they're perfectly spaced. And over here as well, these two bars are the same, right? So the actual parallel lines are spaced the same. So if that's true, it doesn't matter what type of line I draw through these parallel markers, they'll always be cut into perfect halves like you're seeing here. Like this wall was cut into perfect pieces because it crossed through all three parallel lines. When I drew this line, it was cut into equal pieces. When I drew this line, you agree that I went through all three parallel lines. It's going to be cut into equal pieces. That's just how it works. When lines are drawn through parallel, they're cut into equal parts. Well, so in both triangles here, this triangle and that triangle, I have two markers. I have that marker and this marker. As you can see that. Now, they also share this angle. What is that angle called?
Vertical.
Yes, vertical, right? So now, by side angle side, those two triangles are equal. They are equal to each other. So those two triangles match. So I have this triangle equals to that triangle. So basically, this wall right here is the same as that wall. That's what you need to know. From here to there, this wall is the same as that one. Okay, now, is everyone still following with me a little bit? Okay. So I drew the line. I proved those two triangles. Now, we do have a rule that when you have a triangle, so I'm ignoring this piece. When you have a triangle, and you draw the mid-segment of the triangle, this mid-segment is actually the same as whatever the bottom is cut in half. Now, let me explain like why this red piece is the same as half of the bottom of this big triangle here. If you look at this huge triangle, this mid-segment of this big triangle is actually half the bottom, okay? And here's why. Because you can draw a line. I'm gonna draw this line in such a way that it is perfectly parallel to this wall over here. So I don't care where it hits; it can hit anywhere you want. But I'm making that in such a way that this shape is a parallelogram. If you can see it, because I'm making this wall parallel to that wall. So this marker here can transfer down. It can transfer down. Well, the idea is that by doing that, I can also prove that this triangle right here, which you're seeing, I'm going to color code here, this triangle is the same as this triangle, this bigger triangle now. I can prove that by using the same walls and the vertical angle again, and I can prove it using side angle side again. It would just be this long process. Well, the idea is if that's true, if this triangle is equal to that triangle, then this bottom plate, again, this bottom plate is the same as this bottom plate. So there's actually two mid-segments here and here. So that whole bottom is composed of the two. So the mid-segment is equal to half of whatever the base is for this picture. That's for whatever that big triangle is. Because this triangle here actually turned out to be the same as this triangle because of side angle side. I can go through that if you want to see it. But now, when you look at this, let me get rid of all these markers because they're getting confusing. Let me go back to the original here. The whole base of this thing, The original base of this huge triangle that you're seeing here, let me get rid of that marker. Okay, the whole base of this big triangle is composed of base number two of this trapezoid. This is base number two. And this piece over here is base number one. It's the original base from up here. We'll call this base one. Because we said that earlier, this little wedge piece is the same as base number one, this is base number two. Well, the whole bottom of that triangle is base one plus base two. And that's exactly the formula I was trying to show you earlier. That you actually add the bases of your trapezoid, you cut it in half, and somehow this always works out to be the mid-segment. I don't know why this works this segment. That's a huge, long process. I know that's difficult. And when you first see that, you're like, oh my God, that's hard. But once you see that it does work because of the way the triangles actually work out, which is a tough process, The shortcut that I want you to know is that when you have the two bases, whatever the numbers are, let's say this is 7 and 10, you could add the two numbers together, cut it in half, and that'll be this number right here, 8.5. That's the number in between. So 17, so the 10 plus 7, you cut it in half, which is 8.5. Okay, makes sense? Like how we find mid-segments now? That was theorem 2.4. But again, it takes a little bit of understanding, right? You have to understand a little bit about triangles. You have to understand how the numbers work, all that stuff. Okay, moving on. Okay, kites. Here's your new word. This is a word I said I wanted to talk about Friday. I know we weren't going to get to it. A kite, by definition, is a quad, four-sided figure. Yes, this is an actual geometry term. It is a four-sided figure with exactly two pair of consecutive sides being congruent to each other. Consecutive sides, not opposite sides, but consecutive. Consecutive means side by side. So like this, right? On a picture, four-sided figure, when you pick two walls, any two walls that are side by side, those two are equal. So I pick these two. So two pair of consecutive sides are equal. That's a kite. Usually a kite, one of the pair are usually longer than the other two. Because if they're all the same, it would be a rhombus of some sort. I don't want a rhombus. So two pair consecutive sides are equal. Well, when this happens, you have certain properties that come about. Okay? Certain properties happen because of the way the walls match. And really, this picture, if you're kind of looking at it, it's very similar, it's eerily similar to a rhombus. Rhombus, all four walls match, but this has certain pairs match. So it actually has very similar properties to a rhombus. If you think back to some of the theorems we've previously done about rhombuses, one of the ones was talking about like the perpendiculars, or the diagonals, are perpendicular to each other. Well, that's one of the properties. Or the diagonals split certain angles in half. Well, that's still true because of the way that certain walls match. So in fact, let's get to that first one. But unlike a parallelogram, remember this, the opposite sides are not equal. Opposite walls, definitely not equal. That's what separates it from being a parallelogram. It's a kite. It's not even a trapezoid. That's what you need to worry about. Okay, so first theorem, 625, if a quad is a kite, then the diagonals are perpendicular. That was the first thing I talked about a little bit ago. It's like this. So if you have a kite, where you have, consecutive walls are equal, this angle in the middle has to be perpendicular. And the reason why is that these points, B and D, are equal distant from certain walls, depending on how you look at it. So it's equal distant from, C, and, B and D are equal distance from A. So that forces these angles in the middle to be perpendicular, because it actually makes isosceles triangles. When you draw up an altitude through the middle, it cuts the wall in half. So it's actually going back to the definition of isosceles triangles. Okay, questions about this first theorem? Deals with kites. So the diagonals are perpendicular. Now, the other thing we talked about is that on this picture, only certain pairs of angles are equal. Only certain pairs. And this is the tricky part. If you look at this next theorem, only one pair of opposite angles can be equal at any moment. Only one pair, not both pairs. That would make it a parallelogram be a parallelogram. That's one of the theorems. Only one pair of angles are equal. So when you look at this, when you look at a kite, this is kind of a weird kite, only one pair can be the same. So the top and bottom, you can definitely see they're not the same angle. This one is probably acute, this one's obtuse. But one pair are the same. And they prove it the same way. They draw the diagonals in there with the right angles, and they prove that certain angles have to add up to be the same. That's what they talk about. Okay, questions? Again, I'm not going through the proofs. It would just kind of waste time. But certain pairs. Yeah. for? You got your books in front of you, all that good stuff? Okay, now, how this is going to work? And it's not going to be the whole day. We might do a little bit of this tomorrow as well. But we're going to start today. I think you guys will find this kind of fun. All right. We're going to play a little game of Jeopardy. Now, how this works for Jeopardy, it's not going to be a time race for anything. I just want to see, can your group figure out the right theorem? You're going to write it on your marker board here and hold it up, and we're going to score points as we go. Okay, so we're going to do this maybe today and tomorrow, but tomorrow, remember, we're going to do the practice guide first. This will help us review some of our theorems we've done. So, let me hand out a marker here. I'm going to hand a marker to each group. So here you go. Marker. All right. 6-1 all the way to 6-6. So, all right. Now, if you don't know how Jeopardy works, it's pretty straightforward. I'm going to have certain categories up here. Your group can pick. Who would be the oldest in the room? Could probably be the oldest person in the room.
Anthony.
Cade, maybe? Okay, all right, we'll start with Cade's group. You guys can pick first. All right, now, again, this is Jeopardy. So, categories, section 6-1, section 6-2, section 6-3, section 6-4, 6-5, and 6-6, the one we just got done doing. So those are the different sections I'm pulling from. Okay, so here's our board. Okay, now obviously there's points. If you answer the questions correctly, your group scores points. Your group needs to keep track of the points you're scoring. So, because groups, we're all going to go for the answer at the same time. It's not just one group answering. So you're going to have to write down your theorem that you think it is. Keep track of your points. Make sense? Okay, so here we go. Anthony, or your guys' group, right? You guys can pick first any certain category, any certain number that you like. Points wise, what not?
6,000?
All right, here we go. So 6,000. I'm going to put the question up here. You guys can figure out what the answer is. Now, for this section, it could be a vocab word or it could be a theorem because we've had a couple of vocab words in this section. Okay? We ready? All right, here we go. And this could be any word that we've used in this section. Okay, for 1,000 points, here we go. There we go. Well, that didn't work. Let's skip over that. What is going on right now? Well, I just gave you the point on that one.
Oh, we knew it before.
Yeah, sorry. I don't know what just happened there.
What if we had the answer before you had the answer?
Yeah, you can have here, I'll give you an 800-point question. All right, here we go. 800 points, sorry. So, 800 points. A quad with both pair of opposite sides are parallel and four right angles. So if your group knows what word this is, it's a vocab word, write it on your little marker board, hold it up, and I'll give you points. I'll actually give you 1,800 points. I'm sorry about the last one. I don't know what happened. It just didn't get harder. So I'll give you 1,800 points for your group. Okay.
My handwriting's really bad.
Is that it? I'll show you here in a minute. Okay, your group. Okay. Your guys' group already hold it up. Okay. Group. I don't know what that is.
That's Kim's language.
You got a vocab word you want to throw in there?
Rectangle.
Okay. If you said rectangle, you are correct. You get 1,800 points. I'll give you 1,000 for the last one, too.
No.
Okay, so 1,800 points. So keep track of some in your group. Keep track of your score. So that was 1,800 points. So we got three groups of that.
Did all get that?
Yep, you all get that. We're going to add up points as we go. So, because certain groups won't get them right. Okay, all right, here we go. So that was 1,800. So if you're keeping track of the actual numbers here, we've actually done these two categories over here. We've done these two. So now, because we need to see the questions. So these two are gone. So I'll just keep kind of keep track. All right. Since you guys didn't get that question right, it goes on to the next group. We'll just kind of go to the first group that I saw. It was your greatest group back there. You guys were the first to hold it up. Any certain one you like, certain point, certain question, section, whatever you want.
Six.
600. All right, here we go. Okay, for 600 points, a quad is a kite, then its diagonals are perpendicular. I'm looking for what theorem number this is. If a quad is a kite, then its diagonals are perpendicular. This is for 600 points. Okay. I think we got. Okay, we got three groups have locked in their answers. I'm looking for the fourth group. Okay, good. All the groups have locked it in. 625. 6.25. That was good. So kite is perpendicular. That was one we just did a little bit ago. That was actually the last. It was the second to last one. Okay. All right, so, and again, I'll kind of warn you if it's a definition or if it's a theorem number. Okay, so that was for 600 points. So if your groups have it, so a couple groups have 1,800 plus 600 now. I think you guys are 600 now. Okay? All right. Since we got those right, you guys get to stay with it. Pick the board.
6.5, 1,000.
6.5, 1,000. Okay, here we go. For 1,000 points. From section 6.5, a trapezoid is isosceles, then each pair of base angles are congruent. I'm looking for the theorem number. You can look it up in your book, you can look it up in your notes. A trapezoid is isosceles, then each pair of base angles are congruent. Could be from section 6.6 as well. I wonder if that gets spilled over. This one is actually from section 6.6. It got spilled over. It's from section 6.6. Sorry. It got spilled over. This section only has a couple of theorems. Okay? Teenagers are watching other groups. It's going to be hot to have an item more. Okay, good. 621. Okay, hey, groups, when you hold up your things, you got to make sure you're not letting other groups see it. So if you want, I'll come over and I'll look at it. Okay. Okay, that back group. So some of your groups are now up to, what, 3,400 points, something like that now?
Yes.
I think you guys are up to, what, 1,600 still? So. Okay, all right, back group. You guys are still going at it. We've had the 1,000. We've had these three right here.
6.4,000.
6.4,000, okay. For 1,000 points from section 6.4, a parallelogram is a rhombus, then its diagonals are perpendicular. It could be from section 6.4 or 6.5 if this one were a spillover. Usually the 1,000 points are kind of a spillover from the previous section if the section didn't have a lot of theorems. But it could be from section 6.4 or 6.5. Parallelogram is a rhombus, then its diagonals are perpendicular. You think you know it? I want to see the number. Maybe you want to hide it, and I'll come check it out. So this time I'll come check it out so groups don't see it. Okay, this is the last one. Okay. All right. I think everyone got it. 6:15. All right. We'll continue this again tomorrow. So 6:15. So keep track. That was 1,000 points. Some of you are up to 4,400 points, 2,600 points. Keep track tomorrow. We'll continue. I gotta figure out what happened to the last question.
Yeah.
Cam, you need to show Mr. Heatster the lap.
No.
Yeah. So here, come with me real quick.
Thank you.